Can we? Got it.
Oh, right.
Carlos, were you going from recording or were you going live?
Recording. Yes, he wants to do the recording.
Hello, TADWIT 2022 participants. I'm presenting to you the talk Mobilizing and Enhancing Legacy Biodiversity Data, the case of Carl Wilhelm Verhoef's correspondence. My name is Carlos Martinez. I'm presenting on behalf of my colleagues Dorothea Hoof, Mary Meister, and Christine Drilla. Some of you might not know that a part of nowadays France called Alsace was actually part of Germany for 50 years from 1870 to 1920. And that was a time of intense development for the local Zoological Museum of Strasbourg. And the German curator, Dr. Ludwig Döderlein, was in exchange with several German scientists, including Dr. Carl Wilhelm Verhoef, who during that time sold his specimens to the museum, where they remain today. There is a number of what we call Verhoef's problems, like he naming number of species, subspecies, varieties, which have no standing in nomenclature nowadays, so what we call oversplitting, and also name changing from the time that he sold the specimens until the time he actually published the names. There is a high amount of taxon descriptions like him scattered across several hundreds of publications. The descriptions were written almost exclusively in German, which many people don't speak today. It's very difficult to recognize type specimens because of incomplete labels. He also made extensive use of micropreparations for anatomy. He sold his collections to many different museums, some of which don't exist anymore. And the specimens body might be in one museum while the body parts are in another museum. During our work on handwritten text recognition from manuscripts, we made use of the ISDIC deliverable methods for automatic text digitization from January 2019. Figure 2 from that deliverable presents a workflow on digitization of specimens and their labels, but basically it also works for documents as physical objects, and we use it as a reference. With this work, we are trying to provide for the need of taxonomic communities. I participated in the 80th International Congress of Myriapodology in Budapest, Hungary in 2019, organized by the International Society of Myriapodology. And in that Congress, we discussed several of the Verhoef's problem. There we spoke of Verhoef's and his two handwriting styles, the Latin Schreibschrift and the German Current Schrift and Sutterlitschrift. And we spoke of how very few colleagues can nowadays read those scripts. And you will see in the images on the bottom how maybe you can read the first line, which says "Geata her kollege," which is in the Latin script, while you can probably not read the other line, which is in Sutterlin, and which reads "Sehr geehrter Herr Professor." So even if two words are the same, they are very difficult to read. Then we also asked the question, okay, is it possible to use artificial intelligence to transcribe Verhoef's manuscripts? Can we process the scripts separately or together? And is the recognition going to work at the level of individual letters or individual words? The answer to those questions is that there is software to do both manual and automatic handwritten text recognition, like Transcribus, which we use for our work. There is also other platforms like Ascriptorium and Pero OCR. The work can be collaborative through online and desktop clients, and the HDR model, the neural networks, can be trained in recognizing whole lines of text. This is a view of the Transcribus Lite online interface. It is very sober, very user-friendly, It has two main panels, and in one panel you can have the letter or the document with highlighted lines of text, and on the other panel you can have either the automatically transcribed text that then you just have to correct, or you can have the full space for transcribing manually. One feature that we found useful is that when one has tabular text in the manuscripts, one can actually apply tabular structures inside Transcribus to that text, and those can be actually exported as tables. A good thing about Transcribus is that there are readily available public models that might transcribe your documents with good results, maybe up to 90% accuracy. The customized HDR models can be created, stored, and retrained as needed. And the HDR statistics and charts can be automatically generated and therefore reused for publications. With our small corpus of training data, which was only 37 pages, our character error rate in validation data was as low as 5%, which is comparable to OCR quality of printed documents. Here you have a view of the desktop client, where you have rich metadata like pages of ground truth, validation set pages, number of iterations, and so on. And you also see statistics like number of words and number of lines, and then the character error rates for both training and validation data. Then in the online view, you can also have similar statistics and charts. And you also have options for several export formats, common formats like PDF and DOC, but also more advanced formats like XML, Alto, and Tay. And you have even more options in the desktop interface. I also wanted to comment that all these models have limitations just like humans do. So for example, the capital I and capital J were unrecognizable from each other also for humans. So you see that ish and jetzt have letters that cannot be differentiated, and that's the same for scientific names like Julius. And that happens to the publishers as well. So this demonstrates that from these documents, we can learn that some misspellings are trivial and are because some letters could not be differentiated from each other. Then we use the Scratchpad's virtual research environment. There are several reasons why we did that. You can find more on the webpage. And we use one instance, which is called Myriatrix. It's dedicated to Myriapoda and Onychophora, so centipedes, millipedes, velvet worms. And we created a biography for Verhoef. We linked it to Wikipedia. We added Verhoef publications and also the letters. And each bibliographic reference has a landing page with additional data, and it has a feature for tagging documents with taxonomic names, which creates bidirectional links between documents and those names. You can also use a full text field to present the text of archival document, and you can use a simple HTML tagging to link references in the document to external sources. Like for example, in one document, one letter, Verhoef referred to the Kölnische Zeitung, and we found the exact page and we linked it. He also referred to an upcoming publication. We also found it in the BHL, and we linked text in the letter to that publication. And the effect of tagging documents with scientific names is that you create a bibliography of scientific names and the documents, and then you can aggregate all these sources, whether they are newspapers or correspondence or actual scientific articles. And then the automatic tools in Scratchpads enhance those curated results by using APIs like Refindit and the VHL API We use the Scratchpad Darwin Core exporter to create a data set and send it to UBIF. And this Darwin Core archive of myriad tricks you can explore in UBIF itself. And please, if you're going to reuse it and cite it, always cite the platform, so the database itself, in addition to the citation of the data set that is provided automatically by UBIF. Regarding future directions and collaborations, we plan to automatically annotate and extract relevant data from the machine-readable texts that are provided by Transcribus output files to make that annotated text available, searchable, and extractable via our semantic search portal, and to link it to further relevant databases. These are the references, and we acknowledge several organizations that supported our work. Thank you very much. If you have questions, I'm available.
Great, thank you so much, Carlos. That was a great presentation. I see there is already one question in the chat, so I'll start there. Where are the links between items stored in the Scratchpad? Why not in Wikidata?
Yeah, I am not using Wikidata myself, and I have no training in Wikidata. I do have training in Scratchpad since 2016. So this was a software in which many hundreds of thousands was invested by the European Commission. And since then I have been trying to use it. So, and the other thing is that it's much more controlled than the wikis. So in this, you need a certain login and there is authority control and you have an administration and an administrator, which is usually a taxonomist or someone who knows the field. And this is for specific taxonomic communities. So it's more controlled and more curated and I prefer it that way. What would be wonderful is if at some point an export from Scratchpads to Wikipedia or Wikidata is made, and that should be possible.
Okay, great. Thanks, Carlos. I think we maybe have time for one more question if there's any questions in the room. Nope. Okay. Well, let's move on to our next presentation then, which is going to be from Colin Royale, and we are going to be playing the recording. Let me go do that.
This one?
Yeah.
Hi everyone, I'm Yvan Lebras from French National Museum of Natural History and PNGB Biodiversity Infrastructure, and we speak about open science for better fairness, biodiversity, virtual research and environment point of view with Colin Royaux, Elie Arnaud, Julien Sananicon, Marie-Josée, Mélanie Madelin, Dominique Pelletier, Olivier Norvez from PNGB FRB IFEMER Université de Rennes and the Sorbonne University. So starting to speak about virtual research environment, we want to start from the data point of view. And here we can speak about rapidly something quite important with, on one side, the network created by Data One, where you
working
on this ecosystem by NCUS, ETI, US LTR, notably. So here you see just what we can have thanks to this amazing standard, this amazing initiative, and the catalog we can deploy using Metacat open source solution.
Sorry, there's a battery problem with the mic, so just give us a sec. I'm going to go back a little bit because I feel like we may have missed a little bit. So I'm gonna go back a little bit. Hope that's okay for everyone.
With the contribution on this ecosystem by NCUS, EDI, USATR, notably. So here you see just what we can have thanks to this amazing standard. There's amazing initiative and the catalog we can deploy using Metacat open source solution. And one interesting thing, particularly illustrating the power of EML, is the fact that we can describe data attributes on the metadata. So we can have information about detailed information about the data. And additionally, you can add semantic annotation to this data, again, thanks to the ecological metadata language standard. So here you see, for example, for a particular data set, we have access to description of each data files. We can speak and we can capture keywords related to terminological resources, here ontologies, for example. And looking at attributes, you see that you can also describe each attribute and have this link towards ontology or other resource terminological resources. And one of the good things we can do with that is creating automatically a metadata assessment report who will give you results looking at 51 checks on the data and metadata to help people ameliorate the description of the data. So there is really something powerful we can use only you're using open source algorithm and standards. And now from this data point of view, we'll go towards analytics point of view with Colin.
Hi, this is Colin. So in this respect, we started to participate to the Galaxy initiative through Galaxy for Ecology. We proposed guidelines to help create shareable analytical bricks from an existing all-in-one script that makes the whole analytical workflow from formatting of the data to the final models and indicators. These scripts can be very high scientific quality, but their construction makes the whole analytical process very specific to one data type or even one data file. Often it is hard to understand and adapt for another case study. And only by separating it into smaller parts makes it more understandable with fewer parameters to adapt at each level to make it fit for other data types. So to go further, one may identify these key parameters to point out where the analytical process can be altered for other data types and case studies. At this point, not much would be needed to implement the analytical bricks into Galaxy tools with an interface to set key parameters and create a Galaxy workflow. Then tools and workflows can be shared on the Galaxy toolshed, so an app store, if you will. This toolshed permits people to use it as it has been set out originally, but also in other workflows and for other data types that are proper to be used on tools. So with these guidelines, we develop many killer workflows, such as the biodiversity data exploration tools that has been developed by Marie-José during her first internship. So this workflow has been widely inspired by the amazing publication from Zur et al. In 2010, named Protocol for Data Exploration to Avoid Common Statistical Problems. Notably, it proposes tools to visualize a repartition of data in space, time, etc., to see if any bias may be induced in further models. So there's also a workflow to deal with GIS data and NetCDF files that has been developed to make simple tasks such as creating a file with environmental information associated with your sampling sites and a map to visualize it. So this may seem very basic, but usually it takes several programs like R, QGIS, etc., and a lot of manipulations that may take time and computing power, especially with a big data set. So with this and with this Galaxy workflow, you can simply go on the platform and launch it on the Galaxy cluster without crashing your computer, which is very helpful. So we also have essential biodiversity variables workflows based on the framework of Kiesling et al. Published in 2017. So we developed the Stock and Pampa workflows. The Stock workflow has been adapted from the usual analyses that are made by the French Common Birds Temporal Observatory. This workflow uses occurrence data to preprocess and filter data and produces community and population metrics, such as the Community Specialization Index, to analyze its variations through time. Then the Pampa workflow comes from the Pampa application that has been developed to permit marine protected areas manager to analyze their data easily. It can be used from raw abundance data that can be pre-processed using a variety of existing Galaxy tools, such as converting tools, concatenating, etc. So here are some examples. Then data can be analyzed at either community or population levels. At each level, this workflow computes metrics, produces a generalized linear model to evaluate the effects of site, year, and or habitat, and finally outputs time series plots of the computed models. So finally, to ensure the workflows are understandable, to give more information on each parameter, and to give all needed red flags, a Galaxy training platform is available, and the trainings must be following the Carpentries good practices. So we worked some very complete trainings in the ecology section, so don't hesitate to go have a look and give us feedback at this link or by scanning this QR code.
Thank you very much, Colin. So now we'll switch from this Galaxy-oriented things towards other environment around R, and notably using R Shiny. And here I will describe rapidly MetaShark application with a Shiny app, who allows to generate ecological metadata language metadata with a lot of inferences from raw data sets, so we can infer information about geographic coverage, temporal coverage, or taxonomic information based on the content of the data, but also the information about the attributes, thanks to the use of the R package EML assembly line, and then generating a data package mixing data and EML. We can generate such a data package and push it on a catalog from the Data One network. Really briefly, MetaShark is something like just a graphical user interface in front of the amazing EML assembly line R package, where in fact you have a workflow and several steps to generate information about attributes, about categorical variables, geographic coverage, XM coverage, and other information, personal information, abstracts, methods, things like that, before creating an EML. Then I will just switch and speak about another interactive app called Pampa, where in fact we are coming from a TCLTK old app and creating an R package and R Shiny app application based on this to help in fact manager of protected area to generate by themselves indicators, metrics directly from raw data. So why I was speaking about this open source solutions related to HERA and interactive, it's because in fact, in Galaxy, you can integrate such interactive apps. So you can also have Jupyter Notebooks deployed on demand inside Galaxy, and you can even mix on this workflows, Jupyter Notebooks, RShiny app, Java-based tools with classical Galaxy tools. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you so much for that presentation. It looks like we do have a little bit of time for questions. I don't see any in the chat. Are there any questions here in the room? Okay. Well, we will have time at the end of the session for discussions. So maybe things need to percolate a little bit, need to think about them a little bit more. And we will move on to our next talk, which is also a pre-recorded one by Mahmoud Saddighi. And I think I have helped bring it up this time.
Hello, everyone. My name is Mahmoud Saddighi. I am a data analyst in the data management team of the Atlas Object Australia. Today's presentation is about the framework that we have developed in ALA for creating Darwin Core archives, which we call pre-ingestion framework. Topics that I'm going to cover here are an introduction to the Atlas of Living Australia and how data is being mobilized and processed here. Then a list of operations that we cover in pre-ingestion framework, followed by its architectural view. Then talking about the whole end-to-end data ingest workflow. And at the end, I will show you how the whole framework is integrated into Amazon Web Service. Atlas of Living Australia is a national project focused on making biodiversity information accessible and usable. It's funded by the Australian government through the National Collaborative Research Infrastructure Strategy, or NCRIS, and it's hosted by CSIRO and is the Australian node of GBIF. We gather data from different groups and make it available to be used by many other users, which include researchers in different fields of ecology, new species discoveries, systematics, taxonomy, and digitization of biological collections. Also researchers and practitioners in biodiversity conservation and environmental monitoring, sustainable ecosystem development. Government agencies and land managers also are responsible for natural resource management and the environmental impact assessments. The other groups that use ALA is community and education groups involved in ecoscience education and citizen science activities. To make this all happen, we use Darwin Core standard to convert data in a standard format, and we contribute the processed data to GBIF, making it accessible globally. Data processing in ALA can be divided into two stages, pre-ingestion and ingestion. In pre-ingestion stage, we make the data available in Darwin Core archive format, which is the standard input for LA pipeline or Living Atlases pipelines. LA pipeline is the software which is mainly developed by GBIF, and ALA has also collaborated on that project. In pre-ingestion, we do fetch data from the sources. We process them, map data onto the Darwin Core standard, and then create the Darwin Core archive file and push that to the next stage, which is the ingestion. In ingestion, we use LA pipeline to extract the Darwin Core archive, and get the information from there and then run the records through the interpretations, which are taxonomy, location, sensitivity, temporal events. And then at the end, when we added all of these extra information onto the original record, we indexed the interpreted records on SOLAR. And it's now searchable on ALA. Here is the overall architecture of data processing in ALA. As you see, we have big box, which is called ingestion, and it has the pipelines in the middle. It accepts Darwin Core Archive format. It uses different ALA web services like STS, name matching, spatial, different web services to gather information and process the data that's coming from Darwin Core Archive and create interpreted outputs and also index those outputs on SOLAR and make it available through occurrence web services or APIs or ALA website. So this is the ingestion part. But before that, we have pre-ingestion, which needs to unify or standardize all of those inputs, different inputs coming from different sources. In pre-ingestion, we connect to different sources with different formats, with different protocols, or even custom web APIs or databases, iNaturalist, BioCollect, different things that they want to provide data to us, but we need to unify them, make it available as a Darwin Core Archive. That's where the pre-ingestion sits. And now ALA pipeline just worries about what format, what interpretation it's going to do, not about the format of the data coming to as an input. I'm going to point out some of the functions of the pre-ingestion framework connecting to the data source and fetching the information, which can be in different protocols and formats. This function supports downloading multiple HTTP URLs or downloading from a folder-like service, which is SFTP, FTP, S3, those kind of things. And also downloading the latest Darwin Core Archive from a folder, downloading multiple files from a folder, getting information from a web API or database. After that, it's mapping the Darwin Core the tabular data into Darwin Core fields, and it can be different for every data resource. After that, we do the other operation that it does is to combine the data tables and create a Darwin Core archive at the end, which can be like a Darwin Core archive with only one core or Darwin Core archive with one core and extensions based on the number of files that we get, the information that we get, or adding meta XML and EML XML. After that, some other functions that pre-ingestion does is merging multiple Darwin Core archives, which we use for adding a delta Darwin Core archive into the system by merging it with the previous one that we already have and delta onto that. We have added some checks and verifications and some reports saying to spot the problems and speed up the data turnaround. We do processing for images and media files. And also we convert associated media to an image extension in this framework. Pre-ingestion framework, it's written in Python 3 and it's here is the architecture that you can see. It has fetchers at the top, which is the downloaders or the pre-processing of the data based on the data source protocol and format that we are going to interact to get the initial information from them. And then we go through a mapping and processing and create the initial Darwin Core archive And if we need, we will merge the this Darwin Core archive with the current Darwin Core archive that we have, it's Delta, and then we do process images or media and add data checks and results. The Darwin Core archive that we are going to push it to pipelines to be ingested. These fetchers, we have an interface iFetcher, which each of these fetchers implement that iFetcher functions in the framework. So we can add as many as data resource type that we have, and we won't touch the main code of the ingestion framework. In this part, we can talk about the cloud integration that we have for the whole system. We use Airflow to schedule, monitor, and manage the jobs that we will run, data loads. We use EMR cluster, which is the Elastic MapReduce cluster of AWS. You can specify the Elastic cluster based on the configuration that we define. Based on the load that we are going to do, we need a bigger, more powerful, or weaker kind of this cluster. We define that in ingestion or in the job, Airflow job that we have. And we after doing the pre-ingestion, we copy the Darwin Core archive onto S3 and kick off another EMR cluster to run the pipeline. And it gets the that EMR cluster gets the data from S3 and then pushes through the interpretations. Thank you so much for attending my presentation. If you have any feedback questions, please let me know via this email or the support email that we can get in touch. Thanks.
Great, thank you, Mahmood. I do see one question in the chat already. Do you record which Atlas services or version of services are used to augment the data?
Sorry, what?
The mic record? Is on.
Yeah. You can hear me. Yep. Yes, okay. Do you record which Atlas services
sure. or
version of services are used to augment the data?
Yeah, Tim tells me that they can hear me, so yeah.
I
don't know if don't know exactly. is online and able to answer questions.
I don't know, can you hear me? I think that there is a delay, yeah?
His microphone isn't working.
No.
It's Peggy here. I can probably have a little go at answering that question about.
Okay. All right. Well, sorry. Oh, are you there?
We can hear each other. I think they cannot hear us.
Hey. Yeah.
No, yeah. I think you're good. I can hear you now. We can hear you in the room.
Oh, okay. Peggy, you go.
Okay. All right. So, in terms of the Atlas services that are used to augment the data, so Mahmood distinguished between the pre-ingestion framework, which really is just about preparing Darwin Core archives, and then it's actually in ingestion that we augment data with other things like taxonomy and location and all of that sort of thing. So really, in the pre-ingestion framework, there's not data augmentation. It's just preparing a Darwin Core archive with whatever the raw data is that we're given.
Okay, great. Thanks, Peggy.
Yeah, I see there's another question there. Is there a public link to the code on GitHub or GitLab? The pre-ingestion framework that we have done, it is not public because it's kind of coupled with the Atlas that we have, the environment, but we are extracting a generic Darwin Core archive tool out of it, and we are in the process, so it will be public, and it is a like a Python command line tool that you can specify different parameters to do those functions for you to create a diving core archive out of a CSV file or multiple CSV files and add meta XML and stuff, then you have the zip file at the end. Yep.
Okay, great. Thank you. We do have a question in the room, so I'm going to pass it over.
Jörg Holecek, Botanical Garden. On two slides, there was something about image processing. What exactly does that mean? Does it check for availability, or if it's just an HTML page, does it download the JPEG or extracts the JPEG link? So what is image processing?
Yeah, in the actual image processing is done in the pipelines. It means that we have an image service that downloads the file and then does the thumbnailing and extracting data from EXIF. But in pre-ingestion, we had a problem with the pipeline that we cannot have embedded images in the, we cannot ingest embedded images in the Darwin Core archive itself. If a data provider adds images into the zip file and pushes that, it won't be ingested in the pipeline. So that's one of the parts that it does image processing. It loads the images itself and then creates a URL and then gives that. So that's the pre-processing for image, not the image itself. It is pushing the image file to somewhere, creating a URL for it and pushing that URL into the result Darwin Core archive. That's how it works. And also associated media also does the same. We extract associated media, create an extension for it, and identifier will be that associated media URL, and then the type and those fields that we can infer from the URL. Yeah, that's what we do. We don't process images themselves. Yep.
Okay, great, thank you. I think that's all the questions in the chat. If I missed any, okay, John says yes, great. Okay, and I don't see any other questions in the room. Sorry, was there something?
No, I said thank you.
Oh, okay. okay, great. So I will go ahead and move on to our next presentation, which is by Mark Portier, and it'll be a recording. Let me go get that going.
My name is Mark Portier, and I'm glad to be able to present the work of our open science team at LIS on the data management for biodiversity observation networks, or in short, BONS. The domain of these BONS is not too big, but it is already challenging enough. They involve the collaboration between different partners and, within those, specific departments with their own expertise. The data management involved demands to handle diversity and distribution and to offer complete solutions for interoperability and reuse. As such, we believe this domain to be a good testbed for the requirements and challenges in the larger open science community. By focusing on a very specific domain where all partners actually know each other, we can select a simple core technical foundation and surround that with a number of open source tools. This diagram is there to persuade you that the BOND domain indeed has a fair number of complexity. It mainly shows how it consists of many subdomains that all need to interconnect. The actual work is captured in the blocks from sampling over sequencing and analysis to publishing. The actual tasks in those blocks need to conform to common recurring strategies that are expressed or delivered in the other ones around it. To match this distributed way of working, we decided to set up a cloud of interconnected data sets. This allows the participants in the BOND to focus only on the data they need to work on. The connections between the data sets allow to construct a central overview, as well as navigate the path of provenance and independence. The various subdomains all have their own packages and even have their own strategies for creating those. For instance, on the level of the central planning, there is typically just one package. The samplings, however, are occurring at regular times on specific or on these locations. So those typically produce a matrix of packages. The sequencing teams then typically process available subsets of these batches, and thus they typically produce a package per batch that links back to the samples that were included. Next step is the analysis. While the workflows over there are typically run across all the available sequencing data, but are doing so multiple times using either different versions of the software or different fine-tuned settings and parameter configurations. Finally, the publication will provide only one package, occasionally multiple ones, and there you will find the quality stamp results. The model behind this is actually getting its inspiration from how the web works. On the web, a lot of simple and self-contained websites focus on their internal information management. Each of these sites and the detail pages within them are also made addressable from outside. And it is by providing these links that the web was able to grow to the size, complexity, and diversity it holds today. On a more philosophical level, this follows a recurring pattern of building complexity from the simplicity of self-contained building blocks, very much like playing with Lego blocks. For these core data packages, we have decided to use ROCrates, and for us, that's the basic building block. And ROCrates, the ROCrates specification allows to build data packages or ROCrates that contain any file that you'd like, as well as references to files that live online in very specialized repositories. In the context of BOM, these will typically hold images or DNA sequences. Thirdly, it allows to semantically annotate these data packages, as well as the contained files and references. And they do this by just adding a JSON-ld metadata file inside the package. Second to ROCrates, we have decided to use Git as a practical and efficient tool for handling the synchronization of the data between all the partners. Finally, to actually help dealing with the details of our decisions, we are throwing in a number of own tools that help the end users to effectively and efficiently use these technologies. The supporting tools we are currently providing are in the domain of authoring, governance, publishing, but we are also starting to work towards tackling data access in a uniform way across the various packages, and even beyond that, finding a solution that effectively supports federated search across these interconnected data sets. The rationale for providing these supporting tools is that we want to shift from being the bad cop that is only saying what you're doing wrong, to providing the tool that actually helps and nudges you into naturally and easily providing all the information you can share. Another way of looking at this is presented here. All of these new technologies that promise to make the data consumption and the data reuse a lot easier, but most of the time, they are also just making the job of the data provider a lot harder. So by throwing in a bundle of tools outside of the individual researcher, we help to provide something like a digital assistant that could help reestablish the balance. So getting started with the tools, on the authoring part, we have something we call the DM1 assistant. We call this a laptop application. You install it locally like a desktop application, but it is browser-based. It does communicate to a local host web service. And by using this user interface, you can just add files, add references to external stored content, and annotate them all as you need. And of course, you might guess, the combination of those actions are in the background, effectively just building an ROCrate. Next, this local application will also allow you to synchronize your work with the other partners in the model. And of course, That last part is just taking care of using GITs in the background. Then on the aspect of governance and conformance, we are adopting our profiles. These are a new extension to the ROCRATE specification. Look at it like ROCRATE are very open-ended and allow you to do anything. ROCRATE profiles provide a mechanism to tune that down a little bit and to have more strict sets, of practices that people agree upon in the context of a certain application. For instance, a specific subdomain of a specific form. These profiles then get used back in the authoring tool, the one we mentioned before. It works like this: the tool uses the profile to produce upgrades that are conforming to the agreements. And packages that are conforming to these profiles guarantee smooth processing. It allows to make assumptions about what can be found and where it can be found. And this facilitates automation and, for instance, validation process or quality control reporting steps. The third element we have tool for is the publishing part. For this, we are providing a GitHub action, and it really works like GitHub pages. With GitHub pages, one uses an action that converts the contents, typically markdown images and CSS, of a repository into a published static HTML website, while similarly, our action will just convert an ROCRATE Git repository into a static mini data website. And it will just build an HTML view that allows to browse, navigate the package, and to view all the annotations and do the actual data download. The goal is to extend this GitHub action even further and to automatically produce even more desired content. We are thinking about converting the Git log history into some formal provenance publication, as well as producing profile-based quality control feedback on the data contained in them. Additionally, we want to apply semantic uplifting to make these mini data websites actually into five-star linked data members of the semantic web. And that brings us into the further ambition we are having and that we announced as aspects 4 and 5. For those, I don't have much time left, but let me try to capture the essence of our vision. The next thing we want to address is introducing a uniform data access library. The idea here is to hide the complexity of at least the existing unfamiliarity with our DFL knowledge graphs. We adopt RDF because of its flexibility to collect very diverse sets, but these graphs are not how data scientists naturally interact with that data. They just want two-dimensional table-like rows, columns with all the data. They want data frames. You see this in many Excel and CSV files that are used to capture raw data on the input side, but it is also the common model for doing analysis and visualization on the output side. Therefore, we want to offer that exact table-like data access. We want to provide it through a uniform library that hides away the details of how the data is internally structured. So on the outside, it would look like you can call a named query with a number of parameters and get a well-defined table-like result. On the inside, it would typically, in our case, be just executing the Sparkle statements. Next then is finding a way to scale out and have that very approach work across our cloud of interconnected data sets. And in this domain, we are investigating a set of emerging standards, all living around linked data fragments. It actually will come down to extending our GitHub action even a little bit more, now to produce different fragmentations of our data sets, together with instructions on how to navigate these fragmentations. The goal here is to create an open map variant of a database index. And already federated query agents exist that consume these. So what they do is they operate actually like a local database query optimizer, in the way that they can find and fetch the sizes of only the data fragments out there that are needed, and then decide to start with the smallest one to pan out from that point to the associated parts they need. And of course, this will really complete the vision we have in building these interconnected mini data sites. That's it. This is what we call the DMBOM. It's a vision of a vision and a set of tools you were able to build in the context of the BIOS Live project. And this is what I wanted to share with you today. So that's it. Thank you for your attention. And please feel free to ask any questions you might have.
Great, thank you, Mark. We're kind of close on time, but I think we have time for one question. I don't see one in the chat. Is there one in the room? Yeah, it just came up. I'm just checking that no one here in the room has a question. Okay. All right, so I will ask John's question, which is, are the data managed via Git or only the metadata? Are there implications for managing large data via Git?
Yeah, very good question. The answer is both. So the complete autocurate goes into the Git repository. The autocurate holds definitely the metadata JSON-LD, but it can also hold local data inside the package. By the fact that it can also point to and reference online data in other repositories, it can also kind of a group metadata associated to those links, right? So that partially really resolves the issue of having large data on Git, because for the FASTQ and the FASTA files, but also for images repositories, we can just refer to external content that is out there. There is, however, a third part to the answer, and that is using Git LFS. So that's another mechanism people can use to pretend the data is inside the Git repository, but actually the physical storage is kept on a different platform. But the full combination of all of that is in play. And the main thing is, however, that the whole data and metadata is combined and is grouped together. So you never have to wonder where it is. There is one central point, and from there you can find everything. Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Mark. All right. We will transition to our next presenter, who's Katie Pearson, and she's going to be presenting live. Well, virtually, but live. So Katie, do you want to go ahead and give it a try? Mark, if you could mute. Yeah.
All right, are you all seeing my screen?
Yes, I think so. Yes, yeah, we're good. Yep, and we can hear you, so I think you're good to go.
Fabulous. Should we give it a couple of minutes or should we just go?
Yeah, I think we just need to make it bigger maybe here in the room.
Okay.
I think we just need to switch to. Give us just a second more. Okay, now we're ready to go. Thanks, Katie.
Perfect. Well, hello. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a very good morning for me over here. You can tell it's pretty dark here. And I'm excited to talk to you guys today about kind of more of the social side of data mobilization, but it's coming from an open source tool. So I'm going to talk about leveraging the Symbiota Support Hub for biodiversity data mobilization. My name is Katie Pearson, and I'm the project and data manager of the Symbiota Support Hub, which I'll explain in a minute or two. So first of all, what is Symbiota? Symbiota is an open source software. It's been around for about 20 years. And at its core, it's a software for mobilizing biodiversity data, specifically specimen data, but it can be used for observational biodiversity data as well. So Symbiota kind of has two parts. It's both a biodiversity aggregator because it can be used to create themed data portals that contain data from multiple sources. These are community managed often, so by the people who are providing the data. And those data can come in as snapshots, which are copies of data, or they can be live managed within those Symbiota portals. So that's the other part of Symbiota, the software, is that it enables web-based data entry with the editing interface, data cleaning and curation tools, and it supports multiple users. So on its back end, it's PHP and HTML code that links to an SQL database. And it's a pretty simple tool that has really complex efficiencies because it's community curated. So there are a lot of Symbiota portals that already exist. These are just a few of them. Like I said, they're generally themed. There's a lichen portal, there's a myco portal, there's a bee portal, there's an invertebrate portal. And again, these are places where the data can be aggregated and then shared from there. So here's an example from the Turritophyte Collections Consortium. This is the FERN portal, as we call it. This is the Minnesota Biodiversity Atlas, and that's Minnesota specimens from all sorts of collections. And so Symbiota, the Symbiota Support Hub kind of supports two aspects of data mobilization, the technical aspect, so that's the software, and then the social aspect. So in the technical aspect of data mobilization, Symbiota portals allow public searching. Again, it's a mini aggregator. So there are public search and mapping pages that you can use. It has Google Maps built in, and it has this wonderful image interface and searching interfaces. There are checklist creation features. So a user can come in and create a checklist of a region or perhaps a teaching checklist or any sort of checklist from the taxa and the specimens in the portal. You can download the data, usually in a Darwin Core archive, but you can also download it in the Symbiota native format, which is very close to the Darwin Core. And that means that you can include determinations, the links to the images, and trait data, if it exists. So one of the great aspects of Symbiota is that it has really easy import or export and publishing functions. So data can come in from all sorts of different locations. They can be uploaded as a CSV file, or they can be uploaded as a Darwin Core archive. And then it has built-in functions that can package up those data into a Darwin Core archive that can then be downloaded by researchers, educators, the public. And through a web service system, it also has the ability to publish that Darwin Core archive to aggregators. So the data can be really easily harvested by things like iDigBio and by GBIF. So here's an example of a collection that is published straight to GBIF from a Symbiota portal. So once you just set up a couple of settings, it's very easy to send those data directly to GBIF. And that means that you no longer have to, you don't have to install an IPT or go through another IPT. So Symbiota has a long history of having a strong social aspect of data mobilization. And what I mean by that is people who are facilitating that data mobilization, no matter how big or small that collection or data provider is. And recently, in 2021, the Symbiota Support Hub was funded. It's a domain of iDigBio. And our purpose is to support data providers and provide infrastructure services for Symbiota-based portals. So anyone who's using Symbiota code can then leverage this new support system. So this support system is relatively small at the moment. It consists of three leads, Jen Yost, Nico Franz, and Ed Gilbert. And then it has me, Katie Pearson, the project manager, and data manager. It has a community manager, Lindsay Walker, our IT and system admin, who is Greg Post. And then we have Samantha Oriana, who I think is in the audience here, our international community coordinator. And then Laura Prado is a affiliated biodiversity informatician. So we have a group of people ready and willing to help out. And the way that we're helping out with data mobilization is we've provided a help desk service. We have some great new tutorials. I'll put these links in the chat afterwards. And we also have a discussion board so that people from the Symbiota user community can post their questions, ask their questions, and get them answered. So for example, here is a page from our tutorials about data mobilization. Again, we've made this really, really easy through the tools that are in the portals that you can just publish straight to GBIF and not have to set up anything else. Another thing that we have generated or started with the Symbiota Support Hub is these portal advancement campaigns. And these are focused month-long efforts that are aimed at increasing data quality and mobilization within these existing portals and also extending the communities of these portals. So we help with data cleaning, help and training. I like one of the previous presentations said we're going from being policemen to nurses. That's kind of what we're trying to help here. We're not just saying, here are some flags, here are the things wrong with your data, but we're also saying, here are the ways that we can help you fix your data in a batch and efficient way. We're doing outreach to new collections. So there are still many collections that are not mobilized, you know, as they still have their data in a spreadsheet somewhere, and we're helping them get them into portals and potentially manage their data in these portals. We're also trying to get people to publish to GBIF as much as possible. We're updating old copies of data. So there are snapshot data that might be a couple years old and we're trying to get those refreshed. We're trying to help everyone publish to GBIF and to IDigBio when appropriate. And we're also building community capacity. And what that means is providing individualized training, answering individualized questions, because there are many stages in the digitization to mobilization pipeline where people often get stuck.
2 minutes.
Thank you. And so far it seems to be working. We've mobilized over 1.3 million occurrences to GBIF just since February 2022. And that encompasses 20 collections. And this number increases every day. And then for future development and data mobilization efforts, right now we're in the development of an API. And so that API is going to enhance communications between Symbiota portals, but also between other secondary data providers. So now we can get data from all sorts of data providers and provide it to all sorts of data providers. But then using the API, that is an automated way of being able to bring in data from non-Symbiota aggregators and data providers, like getting genetic data, trait data, other specimen data from other sources. So we're really excited for those developments. Thanks for attending today, and I look forward to your questions. If you have any more questions about Symbiota or you just want to learn more, feel free to visit us at symbiota.org, and our new help desk email is help@symbiota.org. Thanks for your attention.
Great presentation, Katie. Thank you so much. John, how are we on time? We're good, I think.
We're doing great, yeah.
Yeah, so I see there's a question in the chat, so we'll start there. What tools do you use to help with data cleaning training with those portal advancement campaigns? Carpentries?
Yeah, great question. So we have some built-in data cleaning tools within the portals, so that can help with normalization of things like countries and taxonomic names. And then we also run a couple of queries on the back end, for example, looking for latlongs that have been swapped. You know, they're in the wrong country, and if you swap them, they put them in the right country, things like that. So we don't do any intensive training. We try to just focus on the low-hanging fruit, and then we train everyone how to use the cleaning tools that do exist so that they are empowered to continue cleaning their data as they have time.
Great, that's awesome. Any questions from here in the room? Oh, yes, Marie has a question. Hold on. She has to get through to get up to here to get to the mic. Here she comes.
Hi, Katie, thanks for the presentation. I was wondering, yeah, hi. I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit more about how you reach out to potential new collections. Like, how do you know where to reach out? Do you have?
Yeah, that's it. That's an excellent question. So we actually go through GBIF's registry of collections for things that may have been imported from, for example, Index Herbariorum, but we don't see them in a Symbiota portal or really anywhere. But we also, during our portal campaign, ask the community, because the community of people who are working in these portals are usually in a geographic or taxonomic space where they're kind of aware of collections that may exist. So we ask them, hey, have you heard of any non-mobilized collections? And then these people often will refer us to, oh yeah, I know there's this one Forest Service herbarium out such and such, here's an email. So it's a kind of a lot of networking and then also just hunting around in the existing registries.
You said that's great. Any other? I think we have just a couple more minutes. Okay. Great. There's one more question I see. Okay. So Matthew Biddle asks, the help desk is a great resource. Is there a way for non-users to search through existing tickets? This could be a good resource for what blockers folks are coming across.
Yeah, thanks for the question. The help desk is mostly internal. You can look at your own tickets, but you can't look at other people's tickets. However, if there's a question that's more general, that we think would be helpful for the community, then we try to post that also in our GitHub discussions, which is the public forum, so that people can comment on that, and then they can also use those to answer their own questions in the future.
Okay, great. Awesome. Thanks so much, Katie. We will move on to our next presentation. So next up is Laura Russell. Laura, are you there? Are you ready to take control?
I am. Can you hear me?
Yep, I can hear you.
Okay, I will share my screen. Sorry, I've got to hide all those buttons. Okay, does it look okay?
Yeah, we just need to get it up here in the room, so just give me a second. Okay, now we're ready. Go ahead.
Great, thank you. Hi, I'm Laura Russell. I'm a program officer for participation and engagement at the Global Biodiversity Information Facility, otherwise known as GBIF. Among other things, I manage the development of and facilitate sessions of the Biodiversity Data Mobilization course. During this presentation, I will describe the role that this course plays in GBIF's approach to capacity enhancement. I will review some of the successes and challenges we've had with this course and discuss the processes used by myself and a team of international trainers and how we've made this course open and replicable. The work we do at GBIF is guided by a 5-year strategic plan, although in this last period it was 6 years due to the pandemic. In the 2017 to 2022 plan, the first work priority has been to empower the global network. This recognizes the fact that GBIF is not only focused on delivering data for use, but also on a network of people, institutions, and countries. This network of people has the largest responsibility for supplying data to GBIF. It is very important then for GBIF, in order to achieve its goals, that we contribute to developing capacity within this network of people. During this last 5 years, along with funds provided by our partners, GBIF has been able to manage over 190 projects, primarily within the Biodiversity Information for Development and Biodiversity Information Fund for Asia programs. These programs aim to enhance capacity to mobilize and use biodiversity data effectively in research and policy in sub-Saharan Africa, the Caribbean, the Pacific, and Asia. Progress and innovation made in the framework of any of these programs benefited the whole community and contributed to empower the global network. By establishing strong linkages between capacity actions like milestones to complete training courses and publish data, and encouraging the replicability of the course by participants to their project teams and local stakeholders, we were able to scale up our capacity activities. It is important to emphasize here that our capacity programs invest first and foremost in people, not in equipment. We believe that investing in individual capacity is an important component in the process of ensuring sustainability of our actions and impact. Broadly, what we are trying to achieve with capacity development in GBIF falls under two main objectives. The first is to develop the capacity to mobilize biodiversity data through GBIF, which includes supporting biodiversity data management and quality. And the second is to develop the capacity to use GBIF-mediated data, both in scientific research and decision-making at all levels. We target these objectives by working to develop capacity on nested levels that you see here, from individual levels to regional levels, all which contribute to our global GBIF network. While all these levels allow us to embed capacity in the layers of our network and supports its sustainability, I will only focus on the individual level in this presentation. The goal of the individual level is to strengthen and grow GBIF's community of practice. And when we talk about community of practice, we mean the individuals with the skills, knowledge, and motivation to share and reuse biodiversity data for conservation and sustainable development and to support others participating in the community. GBIF has a very strong volunteer community of ambassadors, mentors, trainers, and translators. We are very lucky in our community that so many individuals are willing to come together to learn, share, and pay it forward. The GBIF Secretariat, in collaboration with our community of trainers and mentors, have developed short course curricula on biodiversity data mobilization and data use. These courses are available online for self-paced use or can be adapted for on-site or virtual workshops. Workshops based on these courses provide an opportunity to get hands-on skills in data mobilization and data use, and they contribute to developing a peer network. The workshops also have a multiplier effect as the people trained during the workshops are encouraged to further disseminate the skills acquired. GBIF organized 15 training events under the BID program and the BIFA programs for over 370 people. As a direct follow-up, projects funded under BID and BIFA organized over 130 replication workshops that we know of that trained over 3,800 people. In addition, GBIF nodes have reused or adapted the curricula developed under BID and BIFA to their national or regional context through the Capacity Enhancement Support Program. If we look more closely at just the BID program, GBIF organized 11 training events using curricula specifically developed with the aim of equipping BID-funded project teams with skills needed to meet their objectives. These workshops trained over 250 professionals. In addition to providing an opportunity to get hands-on skills in data mobilization and data use, these workshops also contributed to increase the feeling of being part of a community. They also had a multiplier effect through the organization of replication workshops. So far, over 110 replication workshops were organized by the BID-funded projects, training at least 2,600 professionals. BID-funded projects have established over 2.7 million new species occurrence records, among which 2.5 million are georeferenced. 104 institutions shared data for the first time, and 735 peer-reviewed papers used data published as a result of BID in their analyses. Now we'll look more closely at one of these courses. The data mobilization course was developed from late 2015 through August of 2016 in preparation for the first BID Africa workshop. A team of experts from within the GBIF community was invited to share their expert knowledge to help instruct others in how to mobilize data. Previous workshop efforts were focused more narrowly on data quality and data publishing, but for this effort, the team chose to focus on what a project team would need to facilitate their project deliverables, ultimately resulting in published data. Before materials were developed, the team spent time focusing on instructional design elements by defining the goals, learning objectives, and measures of success as an outcome of the course was to provide a digital certification at either a basic or advanced level. It was also decided that the course would be comprised of blended learning, meaning that parts of the course would be conducted online and part in person. Once these elements were in place, materials were developed. The course instruction was complemented by practical exercises guided by a use case scenario. Certification was determined by successful completion of exercises associated with two additional use case scenarios. To date, we have certified 166 individuals in the course, 82 at the advanced level and 84 at the basic level. Materials for the on-site course are focused around an introduction to four main learning areas: project planning to provide instruction in resourcing and organizing a project, data capture to provide instruction on standards and the origins of biodiversity data and types of data that are accepted by GBIF, data management to provide instruction on data quality, data cleaning, transformation, and standardization of data, and data publishing instruction to share data with the GBIF network. Pre-course activities include foundational work to ensure everyone has a similar level of technological understanding. As mentioned previously, the course instruction is complemented by practical use cases that simulate common mobilization project types. We began with three, but now we have four. We continue to look at developing additional use cases to accommodate more complex data types. Previously, we maintained the course materials in Google Docs and hosted the course in an e-learning platform called Camilo, hosted by GBIF Spain. At one point, we maintained three versions of the course to support translations in French and Spanish. But as we made changes to the course, it became increasingly more difficult to maintain the multiple language versions. With the pandemic, we realized that we would need to begin conducting the course virtually, and it would require retranslations of the majority of the materials. So we used this as another opportunity to further refine the course. I worked with several of the original course developers to streamline all the presentations and record new videos. We moved all the materials into GitHub so that we could begin using the ASCII Doctor project that we were already using at GBIF for our documentation guides. The ASCII Doctor project has a table of contents and paging feature that allows the user to pace through the course. It also has PDF functionality that can create a course manual. By using GitHub, we are also able to interface with the CrowdIn tool that we use to translate the GBIF website into multiple languages. Our GBIF informatics team, primarily Matt Blissett, has enabled all the jobs and scripting that produce the HTML pages for the course in both sandbox and production. He has also enabled a few customizations that make it even better, like a search function. And while this took a good bit of work to get the first course going in this format, we now have four courses, soon to be five, using the format. We have a template that makes it easy to get started. If you want more information about how it works on the back end, have a chat with Matt. He's there in person in Sofia. So at this point, I'd like to say that this course would not be possible without the developers of this course and the trainers and mentors that serve as instructors and group leaders to facilitate the learning and provide ongoing hands-on support to the participants. In fact, just a few weeks ago, our GBIF regional contractors in Asia self-organized and conducted a virtual workshop. This is the first workshop for non-funded projects in Asia, and it has so far resulted in seven new data sets published the week following the workshop. So as you can see, our community contributes to the success of all GBIF's activities, and I take this opportunity to acknowledge their work and thank them for their support. Developing capacity at the individual level contributes to empower people and increase data literacy and growth in our community of practice, in turn resulting in a growing number of open data ambassadors, mentors, trainers, and translators. And as you can see from the numbers reflected in our BID impact study to the amount of data made available for research. I'd additionally like to take the opportunity to thank my presentation co-authors, Meliani Raymond, Maheva Bhagar-Larson, David Bloom, Sharon Grant, and Sophie Pamerlan, along with those primarily responsible for the design and instruction of this course. Those with asterisks served as part of the original development team. This is truly one of the best and most collaborative efforts that I've had the privilege to be involved with. Sorry, I'm just gonna end there. It was recording, or it was a narration that was pre-recorded, but this curriculum was originally developed as part of the bid program funded by the European Union. You can visit gbif.org/training to find more information about our training and learning materials. And I encourage you to click through the courses and offer your feedback via GitHub or directly to me. If you have questions on this presentation, please let me know. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Laura. That was great. We have some time for questions. Any questions in the room? I don't see any in the chat. Okay, well, Laura, I'll ask a question. How often at the end of the workshops are data mobilized, like by the end of the workshop, or does it take like months afterwards for data to be mobilized?
Most of the workshops we had done up until this recent one with the group in Asia have been part of funded projects. And so, for example, with the BID and BIFA programs, it is a milestone requirement that they must publish data by their midterm report. And the workshop takes place within the first month or two of their project. So, if it's a year-long project, within 6 months, we start to see at least one data set published. And then by the end of their data set, by the end of the project, the remaining data sets. For this Asia workshop, they had a little bit of enticement and encouragement, but there were 7 projects that published data in the week following the workshop. And I think 5 of those data sets published were from new publishing organizations.
Awesome.
Yeah,
very cool. Okay, that's great to hear. Matthew has a question, but I think we might need to transition. So do you mind answering in the chat?
Yep.
Okay, great. Thanks, Laura. So I'm up next and I have to get all sorted. So give me a minute.
Is your microphone?
Okay.
For this, put your hair.
Yes. No, you're fine. Okay. Yes. Yeah.
This would be good if you put it like this.
On my, okay.
Because you don't have pockets.
I don't have pockets. It's true. Okay. Something. Okay, great. Let's see. Okay, is it presenting to the?
We have you, yeah.
Okay, see, and you see the slides, John?
Yep, we do.
Okay, perfect, all right, yay. This is really close to my mouth and it's making me nervous. I feel like it's gonna be a bug and it's gonna jump right in my mouth. Okay. So hi everyone, I'm Abby Benson. I'm the node manager for GBIF US and OBIS USA. And we wanted to present on an open source workshop that we held earlier this year to mobilize marine biodiversity data. I'm joined by Matthew Biddle from NOAA, Tyler Murray from the University of South Florida, John Pai with Ocean Tracking Network, and Tim Vanderstap at Hawkeye Institute. So one of the main things that I really wanted to bring across is that it took a lot of people working together to make this happen. We had a total of 13 people that were helping with the workshop. This was sort of a surprise to me that you would really need that many people to pull off a workshop, but you really do need a lot of hands on deck. And so we had a lot of organizations who were involved. You can see all their logos here. I won't list them all, but it was really great to have this collaborative working together effort across all these organizations to make biodiversity data more accessible. And the other thing that was a bit of a surprise to me, at least, was how long it took to put this workshop together. So we decided back in August of 2021 that we wanted to host a workshop associated with ocean sciences, which was going to take place in March. And I thought this would be no problem, but it really did come down to the wire there in February when we were trying to get all of our stuff together at the end. So definitely plan lots of time to put together a workshop if you are planning to do a workshop, because it just takes a lot of planning effort if you've never done it before, which we hadn't. The goal of this workshop was to have at least one new data set published in OBIS by the end of the workshop. So I had participated in other workshops before, and you know, it tends to be lots of presentations, people just sitting there kind of trying to absorb information, and they don't really get a lot of time to like put it to use. They don't really get time to work on it with their data. And so therefore you don't really get data sets at the end that are shared. And so that was one of the things that we wanted to address with this workshop, was to try to have data published at the end. And we'll see if it worked in a moment. We had some attendee requirements. We really wanted to focus who was coming to this workshop. So they needed to have a data set to work on. They had to have some R or Python experience, because we really didn't feel capable in teaching people how to code, some knowledge of Git, and a laptop. And originally it was supposed to be in Hawaii with Ocean Sciences, but Ocean Sciences moved completely virtually. So we did too. And we actually kind of disassociated from Ocean Sciences at that point. But so it was a completely virtual workshop. We had a questionnaire when the participants wanted to come be part of the workshop. And in that, we asked them what their blockers were to publishing their data sets to OBIS or GBIF. And they cited training was one. They didn't know how to do it. Time. So they just didn't have time to spend to like do this work of standardizing the data and sharing it and understanding the process. Like, how do I go from here to there? Like, what are the steps that are needed? So this workshop, we really wanted to focus in on those three things. We had 90 people who said they wanted to join the workshop, and we had 63 participants. So overall, I would say it was a success. And I think there's definitely an interest in attending a workshop like this. And so we're really excited about that. We think it went really well in that respect. And we had international participation. So from both coasts of the United States and Canada, South Africa, Europe, and Caribbean and South America. So it was really great to have so many people. And that was one benefit of going completely virtual. We wouldn't have had that level of participation if we'd been in person at Ocean Sciences. We base this on the Carpentries. So the Carpentries has a workshop template, and you can take it and then create basically a website from that. This was excellent because then we didn't really have to worry about building the website. We just put the content in and we had a website, put it into GitHub. You know, we relied on GitHub to create the content and the website, and we used the Carpentries workshop template to give us the framework for doing that. So one thing that we did differently with this workshop is we allowed a lot of time for work. So we had 5 to 10 minute presentations on each of the sections. And then otherwise it was like an hour and a half or 2 hours of work time. So we would kind of give people a, you know, brief, like, here's what you need to know about Darwin Core. And then we had multiple breakout rooms for people to go into about different topics so that if people already knew about Darwin Core, they could go into the dates room and get help with dates if that's what they really needed help with. So had multiple breakout rooms to help people with getting the particular help they needed to move past the blocker that they had. Outcomes that we saw an increase in familiarity with Darwin Core from the workshop, and we also saw that it helped people move past the blockers that they had identified at the beginning of the workshop. So that was really exciting. And the lessons we learned from this was that connectivity can cause problems. So we did have someone who is in the Galapagos and had trouble connecting to the Zoom and therefore missed the presentation and kind of lost track of like where we were in the workshop and where to go and what was happening. So good to keep an eye on that somehow if you can. You need lots of hands on deck is what we've learned. You know, we had to have someone in each of the breakout rooms, people to help with, you know, if people got lost in the Zoom, keeping track of the Slack. So there was just, you need a lot of people helping out. The narrow scope allowed us to focus our efforts. We could really target those people that just needed, you know, the kind of the last steps to get their data mobilized. We did see progress in removing blockers to data publishing, so that was exciting. That's what we wanted, obviously. This is reusable content. This is built using reusable content. You can take this. If this looks interesting to you, you'd like to host a workshop, you can take what we have and, you know, use it for your own purposes. So being open source was definitely a big part of what we wanted to make sure happened. And the breakouts worked, but you do need some vacant breakout rooms so that people have somewhere to go to work so that they're not stuck, you know, listening to people ask a bunch of questions when they just want to be coding, or to also if they just want to have a small group discussion. And so did we get one data set published by the end of the workshop? No, but almost. We were so close. It was like a week or two afterwards, but a lot closer than we had been before. We did end up with 3 new data sets published due to the workshop, a couple of coral reef monitoring data sets and the Wilkinson Basin Time Series Station data set. So that is it from me, and I can take questions, or we can move right into the discussion if there's no questions. I don't know. I'm not watching the chat. I might need help with questions.
I have a question.
Okay.
So did you have trouble reading the... Oh, sorry. Did you have trouble like reading the room and like keeping track of people's engagement when you had such long periods where they're supposed to be working on their own? Because when I've done workshops like this, there's just silence and there's no way it, like if you're in a room, you can look around and see whether people are struggling. And how did you deal with that?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, the breakout rooms were really active. So we did have a lot of people asking questions. I don't know if we could have caught anyone that was sort of lost in things. You know, if someone was quiet and not asking questions in the breakout, I don't know that we would have caught them. I don't know if John or Matt have anything to add.
I missed part of the question, sorry.
You didn't hear the question?
Yeah, I didn't hear it the first half.
Okay. Yeah, the question was how do we keep track of folks who maybe needed help and weren't getting help? But yeah, okay. So. I think that could be an issue to keep track of with a virtual workshop for sure. Are there any questions in the chat? Okay, Excellent. Well, the last part of this session is a discussion about mobilizing biodiversity data and open source approaches to that. So hopefully this gave you a lot of different ways of doing that, different approaches to mobilizing biodiversity data. Does anyone have any questions? I have to look over here. Yeah, Vijay says for virtual carpentries workshops, we have used Slack successfully. Yeah, Slack definitely helps. Okay, do you wanna come up and ask a question? There's one in the chat too, but we'll go with yours, Deb, first.
Hi, everybody. I'm Deb Paul. So I'm curious, from the carpentries point of view, how many of you have never heard carpentries before in the room? Or put plus one in the chat if you've never heard of carpentries. How many in here have never heard of it? So I encourage you to look up carpentries.org and we can talk more about it. But it's a very cool program that involves about five components, very briefly. It's workshops. It's targeted for the most part, depending on whether we're talking about software or data carpentry, the others, at novices, beginning places to get into the world of munging data around to do what you want. But it also encourages and supports mentorship, pedagogical training for how to teach. So you learn good pedagogy. You become an instructor inside the carpentries world. There's mentorship while you're learning that. There's a helper model, so you actually learn how to help first before you become an instructor. And all the materials are developed together community-wide. They're open for anybody on the planet to contribute to fork, convert to different languages, add materials to. So that's carpentries, and I can tell you more about that. My question is, in the carpentries world, in person here, we would use pink stickies and green stickies, or whatever color you want. And they would all be at your desk and you don't have to raise your hand anymore. There's an exercise and you say, work on it. And you have a question, you put your pink sticky up on your computer. If you are good to go and you finished it, you put your green sticky up. And everybody can just look around and it's very easy for an instructor and helpers to see who needs help, who doesn't, who's done, about pacing that Steve asked, for example. How do you do that in the online space? If you've got people in breakout rooms and things and you've given them a task to do, how do they let you know whether they're stuck and how do they let you know whether you're good to go so you can figure out if you need to go faster or slower? That's my question.
Yeah, and so John, did you hear that question this time? Did that come through? Okay, yeah. So
reactions in Zoom is the short answer. And then the longer answer is, there is a sort of list of guidelines for taking carpentries principles online that was very recently published. I do not remember by whom, but the carpentries folks have definitely collaboratively thought about this quite a bit in the recent years because of our circumstances. And we are taking all advice from them as we look to move this sort of concept online. And I mean, the love for the carpentries that we have, I'm not sure if I picked it up at TEDWIG as a bug I picked up a few years ago at TEDWIG, but we took it home to OTN and we trained all of our staff in how to do workshops the carpentries way because of the better response you get from participants. So yeah, I'm happy to co-evangelize it. Matt's got it.
Yeah, I see Matt's got his hand raised. Go ahead, Matt.
Yeah, hopefully you can hear me. One of the other approaches that we took is we had a couple floating instructors. So they were, we had rooms that were dedicated to different topics, but we also had instructors that kind of went from different room, depending on where the need was. And so we did use Slack as well as a way for the organizers to communicate with each other to identify, you know, oh, this person has an issue with dates and times, but it's more of a Python issue. So we'd bring that Python person in to address that concern. So having the flexibility to bounce between rooms and then having the Slack chat on the side to see where specific issues came up was also really beneficial for that.
Yeah, definitely. Thanks, Matt. I'm trying to keep an eye on the chat. There was a question from Esteban. Let me see if I can find it again. Are we planning for making this course annually? That's a great question. And we've talked about whether we're going to do this again. The hard part is everyone's time was devoted in kind. So there was no money to put this workshop on and to continue to ask all those 13 people to provide their time for free is a bit difficult of an ask. So we would like to, but I think it's a matter of trying to figure out if we can find funding to keep putting it on. Let's see, was there another question in there? Yeah, I see Peggy's question is, had some of you actually done any Carpentries training? Can you just use the framework or should you really do Carpentries training yourself first? So I've personally taken Carpentries course before, but I've never done the training. I think Matt has done the training, but I think you can use it without taking the training. Deb wants to jump in.
Sorry, y'all, shameless plug, but it was so exciting. I was part of the team that gave birth to data carpentry. So I am very excited about it and have a personal stake in it. But I would say that everybody, how many people in here have taken the instructor training? And there's already some people in here. So we can tell you more about that. How many people online say yes to that, please? How many of instructor training? Can you put a plus one in the chat? We can see you waving. So I see one, two, but maybe some one, two. John, VJ, yeah. Peggy's question about, everybody can use the materials, Peggy. They are open there. They're free for everyone to use. That's the point. So certainly, but if the full effect of understanding the model of the Carpentries and what it's designed to do, for those of you who want to look at it later, I can show you. I have it on my computer. You can look at their Slack space. You might be gobsmacked, you might not, depending on your gaming and other Slack spaces and Discord that you're in. But there are several thousand people in that Slack space from all over the world collaborating on all of these materials, teaching. The cool part is it becomes this question that you just asked Abby about repeating the workshop. People can then take it up themselves. They don't need you anymore. The materials are there, you become an extension, you become a mentor. They can take those materials, use them. They've now learned how that can go and train the new cohort and grow that community of expertise local to global. That's my take on that.
Yes. Yes. And Matt was really instrumental in us using the Carpentries for this workshop. And so I think he has the exact same point of view as Deb. Although I should let Matt speak for himself if he would like to add anything.
No, I'm good. I think Deb nailed it.
Okay, great. Did people have their cameras on? Did you try to encourage that? We tried to encourage it, but we did have people from all over the world with not always the best connectivity. So they couldn't if their connectivity was not great, because it means they couldn't participate. So I think, you know, we didn't encourage people to have their videos on, but I don't think we made a big to-do about it. Like, we didn't request it specifically that I remember. Yeah. John says we mostly encouraged by example. Great. Yeah. Carpentries. Yay. okay. So any other like big picture question? Oh yeah. Marie. That's okay. A small picture question is great as well. I don't think this one's on yet. There you go.
Actually, that's a question for, I think it was the second talk, Yvonne and Colleen. You mentioned a tool for metadata assessment. I was wondering, it says on the slide, I took a picture and then I looked at it later. It says you do 51 checks on dataset metadata, and I was wondering if, like, where can I read more about this, and is this documented somewhere? Or maybe if you can give a quick sort of idea of what those checks are, that would be really, really nice to know. Because metadata is often neglected when publishers share data, so it's kind of nice if there is a good tool to identify what's missing.
Yeah, they were in the, they had a competing talk.
He's not in the Slack channel now. He may yet respond to it. I've transposed it to Slack, so we'll hopefully get a response there.
But I will say, I do know, you know, they're working with EML and Data One. Data One is very EML focused, you know, so they probably have a lot of checks based on what Data One does. But I don't know specifically. Hopefully we'll get an answer from the Slack. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so, well, if there are no big picture questions, I wish I had a big picture question to ask right now, but my brain is still in Colorado time, and I don't. So yeah, Deb, do you have a question? That's fine. Oh, okay, great. Thank you. Yeah, you have to use the mic so that the people online can hear you.
And Peggy has one online too when we're ready.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Hi, I'm Rukea from GBIP Norway.
You have to go closer.
Closer now?
I think so.
Okay, Rukea from GBIP Norway. I recently was helping some herbaria in Tajikistan to mobilize their data. And what we ended up doing was providing them with cameras to take pictures of their herbarium specimens. And then we trained them to just upload the images of the specimens, more or less without kind of any transcribed data. So I'm interested to know what people think about kind of publishing images without additional data, or with minimal data and data which has been extracted from like handwriting OCR and some basic annotation kind of done on it to make a Darwin Core archive. So this is kind of like quite a different way of thinking about mobilizing and publishing data. You're just kind of putting it out there and then you're going to get feedback and corrections. And the reason why we did it that way was because, honestly, I'm not entirely sure that we would ever have, if we waited for them to write stuff in English and kind of clean their data and correct it, I'm not sure that we would ever get that data online. So I'm interested to know what people think of that approach.
Does anyone want to jump in? Robert online says, how much is minimal enough for item discovery? No, you have to use the microphone. Don't run away.
I'll stay here. Okay. So we got them to at least give the genus name. And then then there's the handwriting recognition, and we have a script which kind of tries to extract the scientific name. In most of the cases, in the examples that we've had so far, it's succeeded. Collector name also, we usually could get reasonably well. And altitude, because that's in Tajikistan, the altitude that a plant has been collected at is kind of important. So little bits of information, not always correct. Discoverable, I would say yes.
Okay. I see Christine has her hand up, but I don't know if it's in response.
I just want to give a comment to this question. If I don't know if I really got the question, but I think it was how good should the data be? Should they be already well curated? Should there be additional information on it, or should it be just the raw data, right?
I suppose I was just looking to get a reaction to see how horrified people's faces would be at the idea of just uploading the image without the.
It's not only, I think the question should not only be about images, but also about the data in GBIF in general, because, you know, I'm working with the GBIF taxonomy backbone, and I find every time I'm working with it, really messy, messy data. And I don't know who is actually curating the data. And that would be maybe the same, then maybe you will find an image there and there's no data presented together with it. So how will you then judge about the data? Is it good data or not good data from where they are from? So there should definitely be a minimum on data be available on every data point, being a picture or, I don't know, a species occurrences data or something like this. But I don't think that we need more and more data that are just data without any metadata or being not corrected data. That's very time-consuming work that people that reuse the data afterwards.
Yes, that does make sense.
Okay, Katie, you have your hand up.
Yeah, and I don't come from the GBIF perspective. I'm kind of more on a moderate aggregator perspective. But for a country that is probably fairly minimally digitized, I would say get as much data out there as possible, because we don't know how long those specimens, I mean, there's possibilities that those specimens might be destroyed. Probably not, but you know, it's just good to have a record of the data that are out there. And the minimal data that you are gathering seems like enough that people would be able to see what has been omitted from that data, from those data points. So you know, you can tell that there is no locality data, there are no coordinates. Those are really easy to omit from your research data set if you're trying to use it. I think it's the utility also depends on what your next steps would be. If there are plans, if they are, you know, packaged into a data set and you're making plans to get those transcribed, maybe through citizen science, like I saw Vijay recommended Notes from Nature. So I think if there's a pathway to getting them more fleshed out in the future, then that is most helpful. But I'm of the opinion that it's good to get the data out there.
That's also really good to hear. And at least one of the herbarium buildings was almost destroyed in the Civil War. So destruction of the material was something that was uppermost in our minds when we were kind of thinking about this as well.
Yeah. Thank you. Mark?
Yes. I was also taking a more general view on the question. As soon as possible, and actually allowing for a very transparent way of having people look into issues that are raised upon it, and then fixes that were applied to it as well, and have that managed in a way that is different from the actual publication phase, where you say this is my curated data and now it's finished, which is the way you address, I think, the two speakers ago, two reactions ago, somebody said we don't want to be wasting more time on the dirty data. Yeah, I get that. For that, there is publication standard quality, a publication standard for data, but that doesn't mean you shouldn't have an open and very transparent way of managing your data as soon as possible. And then as what your question is about the minimal stuff, for me, the minimal stuff is to have an identifier. as soon as possible, so you can keep track of whatever is being said about it. And in case you're worried that multiple identifiers for the same thing might exist, I think you should have, as soon as possible, as much, as metadata that is actually required to make sure that people in a natural way can identify that whatever it is about. That if at some moment a different source of metadata or data about this object is emerging, that people can identify it's about the same object. But apart from that, I would definitely applaud the approach to go live as soon as possible.
That's really good to hear. Thank you. We did, we have trained them to print out UUIDs on QR codes with UUIDs that they stick onto the specimens before they image them. So I think we have the identifiers at least. And yeah, the metadata, as part of the workshop, we got them to fill in. The problem is that they don't speak any English, so they filled us in Russian, and that's kind of okay, I think, until we can find somebody to help us translate it a bit. Yes, but it's nice to hear that people think that kind of going live first is a good option in this particular case. And maybe it's the case for other countries as well, not just, Tajikistan.
Yes, thank you so much, Rukeya.
Yeah.
All right, well, we have reached the end of our session, and I want to thank all of you for coming, and I hope you enjoyed the session. I hope you found something that you might take and run with. Enjoy your break, and thank you. Ask you about this.